The resource-rich waters off Alaska's coast have played an important part in the economy of U.S. and foreign nations for many years. The impact of intensive fishing during the 1970s has brought a new reality to American fisheries: the need for conservation. For the past decade, the U.S. government has been trying to wean foreign fleets away from our bottom fishery. This effort is intensifying under pressure from American fishermen and processors. It's called Americanization. Intensive fishing by foreign fleets in the 1950s and 60s nearly wiped out some stocks of bottom fish. By the early 1970s, fishing pressure, particularly by the Japanese, seriously threatened stocks of pollock and cod. In response, the U.S. Congress passed the Magnuson Act of 1976, declaring a 200-mile fisheries conservation zone, the FCZ. The act said no foreign vessel could fish within 200 miles of our shores without a federal permit. The U.S. Coast Guard was charged with enforcing the new law. Alaska, with a coastline longer than the rest of the coastal states combined, poses difficult law enforcement problems for the Coast Guard. Patrols by air and water attempt to ensure that foreign trawlers within the 200-mile limit are authorized to fish in our waters. Coast Guard boarding parties check foreign vessels to see that permits are in order and that catch reports are maintained. Vessels without permits or in violation of other FCZ regulations are fined or confiscated. In 1984 and 1985, the Coast Guard issued more than 100 citations to foreign vessels. The Magnuson Act was concerned with more than just conserving our dwindling bottom fishery. It created 8 regional councils to allocate the resource to user groups. The North Pacific Fisheries Management Council was established to manage the Alaska region. Jim Branson is the executive director.
Its specific role, the North Pacific Council, is to manage the living fishery resources in the fisheries conservation zone, now the exclusive economic zone of the United States, which is from 3 to 200 miles offshore. And that's all of the coastline of Alaska in this particular case. And the council develops management plans for each of the fisheries out here, which are then implemented by the Secretary of Commerce through the National Marine Fisheries Service. One of the things that the council does every year is establish the amount of fish that are available to be taken by fishermen.
The council's role in allocating the harvest first to American fishermen and allocating what was left over to foreign nations was designed to encourage the development of a domestic bottom fishing industry. This new policy had little effect on the fishing effort of Alaska's fishermen. As long as prices remained high and catches were good, fishermen continued to concentrate on high-value species like crab, shrimp, and salmon. Pollock, cod, and other bottom fish species occur in abundance around the world and are fished intensively, resulting in a world price as low as 4 cents a pound. A few Alaskan fishermen, like Thorne Tasker, were interested in the potential of this new fishery.
We have a tremendous resource. And back in 78, 99% of all the bottom fish that was being harvested in Alaska was being caught and processed by the foreign factory fleet. We could see them when we were out catfishing on the horizon. So quite a few fishermen were pretty interested in trying to develop something on their own for quite some time. The problem is it's hard to switch from a very high dollar value a species like king crab, where the fishermen would get up to $3. At the very end, we get $4 a pound for something as cheap as 4 cents. So there's a whole different mental process goes through a person. I mean, you start looking at, instead of pounds, you start looking at millions of tons.
The state of Alaska, in its search for industries to assist with its new oil wealth, sensed an opportunity. In 1979, the Hammond administration sent a fact-finding commission to Norway, Denmark, and the Faroe Islands in the North Atlantic to study their traditional bottom fishing industry. The commission was impressed with the sophistication of the Scandinavian boats and trawls and with their modern port facilities. But while Alaskans wrestled with the problem of developing the gear to catch bottom fish, an even greater problem would surface: how to sell it. The only substantial market for our bottom fish was in Asia, and that was fully supplied by the Japanese and Koreans. The U.S. Congress tried to deal with this problem through the American Fisheries Promotion Act of 1980, also called Fish and Chips legislation. Under this policy, if foreign nations wanted a fishing permit and an allocation, they would be required to purchase additional fish from U.S. fishermen.
And essentially what they told the foreign countries that are fishing over here is that we're not going to just let you fish for these anymore. We simply think the United States should have something in return in the way of helping the American industry. If you buy fish from the United States industry, that will give you a better allocation for directed fishing. And we are going to insist that you do that. And so the foreigners...
The direct result of fish and chips legislation was the creation of a new fishing relationship between U.S. and foreign fishermen called joint ventures. Joint ventures have proven very profitable for Alaskan fishermen over the past few years after overcoming many difficulties. Foreign nations resisted purchasing fish they traditionally harvested themselves. Some foreign fishermen were accused by American observers on board of sabotaging their own joint ventures in an effort to keep U.S. boats out of bottom fishing. A number of American skippers claimed foreign fishermen were underlogging their joint venture catches. Japan, which takes by far the largest amount of bottom fish in the FCZ, refused to take part in joint ventures except in a token way, yet still received an allocation of 1 million metric tons a year, a situation viewed as favoritism by U.S. fishermen.
Well, the Japanese are a special situation. They have always been the largest participant in the fishery off Alaska. They have an enormous fishing industry of their own, very heavily capitalized, geared to catch and process. And they have very stiff, very difficult controls in their own country on the import of fishery products of certain sorts. Particularly those sorts where their own industry is involved. Pollock, for instance, is very, very difficult to sell into Japan. It's not necessarily because the tariff is high, they simply have import quota restrictions. Sometimes they won't let anything in of a particular type of product because it competes directly with their fleet. But because they are dependent on this allocation, they have been cooperating, although I must say somewhat slowly at times, in terms of joint ventures. And of course, Japan has always been our biggest market for our traditional species of fish, salmon, crab, herring, this sort of thing. We sold almost $600 million worth of fish to Japan last year, and a great part of that was from Alaska.
The harvest of bottom fish off Alaska during the past 20 years illustrates the trend toward resource conservation and the entry of U.S. fishermen in the industry. The total bottom fish harvest by all foreign nations was over 1 million tons in 1967 and shot up to over 2.5 million tons in 1972. Shrinking populations of fish then caused harvests to drop off sharply. In 1977, initial enforcement of the Magnuson Act cut back the foreign harvest to about 1.5 million tons. Japan alone accounted for 80% of the catch. By contrast, the U.S. fishing industry's harvest has been almost non-existent. Joint venture harvests, despite early problems, have grown phenomenally over the past 5 years. Ironically, the success of joint venture operations has created political problems within the U.S. fishing industry. Joint venture fisherman David Harville doesn't want Americanization to proceed faster.
I think the Magnuson Act is doing its thing. I think that we are taking our place in the world of fishing at a pace much more rapid than the Magnuson Act ever dreamed we would. And I think that artificial forcing of anything any faster than what we're doing is uncalled for at this time.
Rick Lauber, who represents the Pacific Seafood Processors Association, contends that without Americanization, there will be no processing industry.
Well, let's go back to the Magnuson Act, or the 200-mile limit law. We all thought at that time that we were Americanizing the industry. It was a loophole or whatever that was found that has prevented us from Americanizing the industry. The answer is, can we process and market the product? We can't do that unless we have the Americanization policy. We have competition from the foreigners. They have benefits that we don't receive. And therefore, we need some further help. In other words, we need to fully implement the intent of the 200-mile limit law. And that's what we're asking for. We're asking for what we thought we were getting a decade ago.
Now, an awful lot of the American fishery is still what we call joint ventures, where the American fisherman catches the fish and then delivers it to a foreign processor and is paid for it on that basis. That's certainly better than having the foreigners catch it and process it, the whole thing. But we look forward to the time, hopefully in the reasonably near future, when the Americans catch all of it and process all of it. I think the chief complaint of most of the U.S. fishing industry is that things have not moved as fast as they would like to have seen them move. We're 8 years into this now, and we still have a foreign fishery off Alaska, for instance.
The movement to Americanize the bottom fishing industry is well underway, but there is widespread disagreement about when and how it should happen, and whether it is a good policy at all. The dismal performance of the U.S. fish processing industry in the late 1970s is still fresh in the minds of U.S. fishermen.
I came to Alaska in 1977 at the request of Governor Hammond to come up here and help Americanize the trawl fishery. And at that time he said we were going to need 700 catcher vessels to Americanize this fishery, and we're going to do it in a period of 5 years. Well, in that first period of 5 years, I had three American processors go bankrupt on me. I have had over $750,000 unpaid to me by American processors, and I have a real problem of being real defensive of the American processing industry as it stands today.
Joint ventures are profitable for U.S. fishermen and involve relatively few risks, unlike fishing for the domestic market. That's why joint venture fishermen aren't anxious to see this new and important source of their income legislated away before U.S. processors are in business. The Aleutian Harvester is a catcher boat for a joint venture between Alaska Joint Venture Fisheries and Samho Mulsan of South Korea. This operation is typical of many joint ventures now going on in the Bering Sea and Gulf of Alaska. Using modern electronic technology, the boat's skipper reads the ocean bottom. Where the continental shelf ends is where the greatest concentration of bottom fish are found. The fish are seen electronically. The colored lines on the screen tell the skipper the species of fish and the depth and density of the school. When he sees a large concentration of fish, the trawl is set. The heavy steel doors plow along the bottom, creating a sand cloud that herds the fish towards the mouth of the trawl. The fish try to swim ahead, but eventually tire and fall back into the net. Smaller fish escape through the large mesh. The larger ones accumulate at the rear of the net, the cod end. The skipper monitors his trawl closely to avoid hazards on the bottom. When the fish can no longer be seen on the electronic finder, the trawl is pulled in. This catch of pollock will be transferred to a mothership for sorting and freezing. The fish are sold at a pre-negotiated price, usually around 4 cents a pound, making a 40-ton cod end worth over $3,000. The Taebec 29, a Samho Mulsan factory ship, stands by waiting for the harvester to begin the transfer. This type of joint venture is called an over-the-side joint venture. The American fishermen don't handle the fish. They simply transfer the catch, net and all, to their partner in the joint venture. In the process of Americanizing bottom fishing, joint ventures will cease to exist. When that will occur is uncertain, but the domestic allocation of bottom fish, though still small, is more than twice what it was 3 years ago.
A small boat can sometimes catch, let me give you a real number here. I know of boats that averaged 300 metric tons a day. Now you multiply that times 2,200, and that's a tremendous volume of fish. And the Japanese and the Russians and the Koreans have all been amazed that these little boats, they consider our boats little, are out there with just a few guys and can fish around the clock, day in and day out for months, and produce the kind of fish that we can produce. They can't duplicate that with their own big ships with hundreds of men. Now most of these ventures, they're limited by the factory ship, not by your catching ability. That's quite a main issue with the fishermen when they negotiate a contract. Their main interest is not the price, but how much can they deliver per day? You know, that's their guiding thing, because they know how much they can catch.
The crew of the Korean ship casts a line overboard, which the crew of the harvester will attach to the cod end. This 35-ton catch of pollock is a small part of the 18,000 metric tons allocated to this joint venture. In 1985, nearly a million metric tons of bottom fish was allocated to 30 joint ventures off Alaska. American fishermen have demonstrated that they can trawl with great efficiency. Why hasn't American ingenuity and industry developed the processing and marketing end of the business?
I don't think that when the time comes that we are harvesting and processing the product, that we will necessarily use the same markets that are being presently utilized by the foreigners. We see a tremendous development in the United States for markets. Seafood is on the upswing in the United States. The per capita consumption is increasing. Surimi production and the new analog products that many people have seen, the artificial crab and artificial scallops and so forth, an excellent product that is finding favor in the United States market. Of course, it originated as a market in Japan, and we hope to open those markets up at such time as they change their tariffs and trade barriers that prohibit us from marketing that type of product there. But we have markets that can be developed in the United States, and that may be where the future of Alaskan fisheries is in the United States market, a stable market, higher income.
A small U.S. market and an almost non-existent processing infrastructure make it extremely costly for a processor to go into business. But slowly, an onshore processing industry is developing in Alaska. Working with a grant from the federal government, the Alaska Fisheries Development Foundation is testing a process that may at last make bottom fish products economic to produce. This machine is capable of producing pollock fillets at the rate of 240 per minute, faster than ever before, and more profitably.
And that machine does have an ability to process a varying size range of fish, and I think this is key to its eventual success. I don't think that's not the end of the game. That's the beginning of technological change in that part of the industry, and I think that's what will make a 4-cent fish economical.
It appears that the real promise for the future of our bottom fish processing and marketing business is in the production of surimi, a high-protein paste made from the flesh of pollock. Surimi is base material for imitation crab meat that has appeared in U.S. supermarkets and may become a base for many products to come.
I would say that of probably the top 20 grossing food companies from the kinds like the General Foods, the General Mills, the Pillsbury's, the Ralston's, the Heinz, those kinds of firms, probably at least 15 of the top 20 in the nation are looking at it. They move slowly, they move cautiously. But if one of them pops, everybody else will be following. I think that that's one of the other things that is tough to put your finger on right now. Are all these companies really that excited about surimi, or do they realize there's potential there and they don't want to be too far behind if somebody else breaks from the starting gate?
Perhaps the biggest obstacle to an all-American fish processing industry in Alaska is the high cost of transportation.
It's actually cheaper to ship something from Dutch Harbor, say, to Portugal in a foreign tramper than it is to ship something from Dutch Harbor to Seattle in an American coastwide trader. So you can see that the competitive edge that the foreigners have. Now this is partly because of physical facilities that they have that we don't in Alaska, and partly because of U.S. law, which requires that we haul all products coastwide in American ships. And when you consider that our best market really is the United States, why, that's quite a handicap.
Despite economic and political barriers to processing and marketing, the policy of Americanizing bottom fishing is going forward. Today, fewer species of bottom fish are allocated to foreign nations than just a few years ago. With more bottom fish being taken by American catchers and declining numbers of bottom fish due to intensive fishing, we may see substantial cutbacks in the foreign allocation soon. But Korean joint venture fishermen don't believe Americanization will proceed as quickly as some think.
Well, first of all, we don't believe that the United States government will do such foolish action, will take such foolish action. Of course, 98% or 99% of your population who has no knowledge of the fishery or no knowledge of the economics in this area may think that by phasing out the foreign fleet, that the United States industry will profit. But the truth is, it will not profit by phasing out the foreign fleet suddenly. The jobs will not increase, because right now bottom fish are very cheap, cheaply priced species, and the production cost, the processing cost has very high weight on the final products. And if Americans were to process them themselves, it will come up with a very highly priced products, which American market cannot accept and which cannot compete with other food items in the market.
U.S. Senator Ted Stevens thinks the American consumer will benefit from Americanization.
Actually, when you take American pollock, and it is pollock, our pollock in our waters, that is, caught by foreign fishermen or joint venture people, taken to Korea, thawed, processed, frozen, then processed in either Japan or Rhode Island and gotten primarily to the consumers in California. We've got a lot of room for the application of high technology and for a direct from the waters to the consumer concept. We should be taking Alaska pollock to the California markets directly from Alaska. It should not have to go almost around the world before it gets there.
No one is betting when Americanization will take place, but Jim Branson believes it may be sooner than most people think.
I think as far as an entirely American fishing industry goes, it won't be very long. 3-4 years, 5 years maybe at the most. As far as a completely American fishing and processing industry, it will be longer than that. But again, not as long as most people seem to think now.
Whether the catch of bottom fish off Alaska will be Americanized next year or in the next 10 years depends on many factors, including international politics and economics. Factors far beyond the control of American fishermen, processors, and resource managers. Important questions continue to haunt the U.S. bottom fishing industry. What will happen when foreign nations are finally forced out of our waters? When they leave, will they take our principal market with them?